gift of eternal life. Father, I thank you that last Wednesday evening our boys and girls stood and quoted verses of Scripture. Father, I thank you this morning that our boys and girls went around Sunday school rooms and they collected money for shoeboxes. Father, I'm grateful that our children so far have collected enough money to send over 80 shoeboxes. Lord, I'm so grateful that this morning my friend Gage led us in the pledge to the flag. And yet, Father, what we see is a religion called ISIS that would kill 74 children. Dear God Almighty, I pray that you would raise up a leader who would be strong enough and bold enough to confront ISIS. God, I pray that you would raise up in our nation men and women of courage that would go to the Congress, to the Senate, to the White House, to the Supreme Court. Lord, that would reverse the terrible deed done by our Supreme Court justices last week. But God, you've given us the formula. If my people, which are called by my name, would humble themselves and pray and seek your face and turn from your wicked ways, then you would hear, then you would forgive, then you would heal. So God, it is my prayer that in churches all across America today, Christian people, studying your word, being emboldened in their faith, God, I pray that we'll walk out of our church building ready to be salt and light for Jesus. Father, thank you for Jesus. Thank you for the United States of America. Thank you for the great freedoms that we have. Thank you for the foundation of our nation. Dear God, I pray that in these times that we live, that you will instruct us, embolden us through your Spirit. And God, may we become the salt and the light that you've called us to be. Father, for those in our church family that are struggling, in need of jobs, I pray, God, in this economy, that you'll provide them employment. For my friend Sylvia, who's in the hospital, I pray, God, that you'll give the doctors wisdom as they treat her. And God Almighty, today, as we prepare to open our Bibles, it is my prayer, God, it is my prayer, as we prepare to open our Bibles, that you will open our hearts and open our minds as we prepare to study your word. This is my prayer this day, in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, no matter where you're at, Jesus has been there. Let's continue our study, walking in wisdom. Today's sermon is understanding and responding to persecution. I invite you to open your Bibles to Mark chapter 13, verses 9 to 13, or if you have an electronic Bible, you can feel free to go back to the back and let Greg give you a Wi-Fi connection so that you can turn on your Bible. I want to remind you of the context in which we find ourselves. The Lord Jesus is on Tuesday of the week in which he would be crucified on Friday. And on this Tuesday, it's been a very, very long day. He has been questioned by the Sanhedrin. He's been questioned by the Pharisees, the Herodians. He's been questioned by the Sadducees. He's been questioned by a teacher of the law. And then the Lord Jesus says to his disciples, it's time to leave. And according to Mark chapter 13, verses 1 and 2, he leaves the temple for the very last time. And as he's walking out of the temple for the very last time, the disciples are remarking about what a great building it is. And Jesus says to them, listen, I want you to know that the time is coming when not one stone of this great building is going to be left on top of one another. And so the disciples were wondering, when would this be? And so in Mark chapter 13, verse 4, here's what I read. Peter, James, John, and Andrew ask him privately, tell us when will these things happen and what will be the sign that they are about to be fulfilled. So the disciples are asking two questions, when and what. When are these going to be fulfilled? That's going to take place later in the chapter of Mark 13, so you can just put that question aside. Then he says, what? They said, what are the signs that this great temple destruction is about to occur? And the answer to when and to what is the rest of Mark chapter 13. And we call this affectionately the Olivet Discourse. And the reason we call it the Olivet Discourse is because as Jesus is leaving the temple for the last time, he and his disciples walk across the Kidron Valley. They climb about 100 to 150 feet above the temple in Jerusalem, and they're sitting on the Mount of Olives. And so as they're sitting on the Mount of Olives, overlooking the temple, Jesus begins to answer their questions, when and what. As he answers their questions, we came last week to Mark chapter 13, verse 8, and in Mark 13, 8, Jesus said these words. These are the beginning of birth pains. These are the beginning of birth pains. And so if a lady is about to give birth to a child, the birth pains increase. Jesus is talking about the birth of his kingdom, his messianic kingdom, his thousand-year reign here on earth. And as he's thinking about his thousand-year reign on earth, he says these are the beginning of birth pains. In other words, when God begins to establish his thousand-year reign, there are certain things that are going to happen. Prior to the thousand-year reign or the millennium that we know it, there will be the second coming of Jesus. Prior to the second coming of Jesus, there will be a seven-year period of tribulation. Prior to the seven-year period of tribulation, there's the rapture of the church. Now, the disciples didn't have all of this in mind, but you and I do because we've got the rest of the New Testament. And so Jesus says, now listen, before the establishment of my kingdom here on earth, before I do that, I want you to understand that there are going to be certain events that are going to happen. And he begins to tick off those things that are going to happen. He says one of the things that's going to be prevalent, or one of the things that's going to escalate, is that there will be deceivers. And so in verse 5 he says, watch out that no one deceives you. Many will come in my name claiming I am he, and many will deceive. Now I shared with you last week that the only way you would be deceived is if you reject the truth. Because the Bible says in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2 verse 10, and in every sort of evil that deceives those who are perishing, they perish because they refuse to love the truth and be saved. And so none of you have to worry about being deceived as long as you follow the truth of God's word. As long as you're walking in wisdom, you're not going to be deceived. Jesus says not only will there be an increase in deceivers, he said there will be an increase in wars and rumors of wars. He said when you hear of wars and rumors of wars, do not be alarmed. Such things must happen. But the end is still to come. Nation will rise against nation, kingdom against kingdom. So he says, now listen to me. He says, I want you to know that there are going to be wars and rumors of wars, but just because there's wars and rumors of wars, it doesn't mean that he's coming again. He says there's going to be an increase of wars, there's going to be an increase of nation versus nation. Why? Well, it's obvious. When you take a culture like our culture, when you take government, take culture, take education, take a societal culture like ours, and you kick the God of peace out, you kick the Prince of peace out, you kick the Spirit of peace out. What happens when you kick the God of peace, the Prince of peace, and the Spirit of peace out? The natural consequence is there's going to be conflict. And so Jesus says, look, as you get closer and closer and closer to my kingdom, there's going to be an increase in deception, and there's going to be an increase in conflict, and the increase in conflict is because you keep kicking the God of peace and the Spirit of peace and the Prince of Peace out. Then he says, not only is there going to be national conflicts, he says there are going to be natural disasters. He says there will be earthquakes in various places and famine. He says these are the beginnings of birth pain. And that's where we left off last week. And now this week, he starts in verse 9, and he says, you must be on your guard. You will be handed over to the local councils and flogged in the synagogue. On account of me, you will stand before governors and kings as witnesses to them. So here's what's going to happen. You're going to have an increase in deception. You're going to have an increase in wars and rumors of wars, natural disasters, national conflict, and you're going to have an increase in persecution. As you see us getting closer and closer and closer to the rapture, to the tribulation, to the second coming, into the millennial kingdom, you're going to see an increase in these events. One of the things that you'll see an increase is in persecution. I found it interesting that the president of Open Doors, now Open Doors is a Christian organization that helps persecuted Christians. The president of Open Doors said, June 2015, quote, the past 12 months have been the most difficult and dangerous for Christians in the 25 years we've been recording such instances of persecution, and in the 60 years we have been working. So the president of Open Doors, a Christian ministry dedicated to helping Christians who are being persecuted, says, the last 12 months have been the worst in the 60 years of their ministry. So the Bible says you will begin to see an increase of persecution. So let's take a look at what Jesus says in verses 9 through 13. We're going to look at 9 very quick characteristics of this upcoming persecution. He starts in verse 9 and he says, you must be on your guard. Now, if we were reading this in the Greek New Testament, what he would say is, but you be on your guard, you yourselves. In other words, he's saying you need to be prepared for persecution. You yourselves, you need to be prepared for persecution. So what he's saying is, whether it's the disciples, whether it's you and me, we need to be prepared for this upcoming persecution that is coming our way. And quite frankly, the disciples who asked the questions needed to be prepared for persecution. Do you remember who they were? Well, there was Peter. What happened to Peter? Well, Peter was crucified upside down in Rome. There was James. What happened to James? Well, James got run through with a sword. He's the first Christian to ever be martyred for the cause of Christ. There was Andrew. What happened to Andrew? Well, Andrew was crucified in Greece on an X-shaped St. Andrew's cross. And there was John. John was banished to the Isle of Patmos, an island 8 miles long, 5 miles wide in the Aegean. So he says, you must be prepared for persecution. So that's a word for you and for me. The second thing he says about persecution is that you will be persecuted, verse 9, as you are handed over to the local councils and flogged in the synagogue. On account of me, you will stand before governors and kings, and you will be a witness to them. So not only is the persecution personal, but the persecution is going to come as you and I, or in this case, the apostles, take a stand for Jesus Christ. As they take a stand for Christ, they're going to be hauled into the synagogues, and there they're going to be beaten or persecuted. According to 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 24, they would receive 39 stripes. So the persecution is something that will happen in religious circles, but it's also something that will happen as you're called in before governors and kings as witnesses. So you've got this personal persecution. And now he comes and he says in verse 9, on account of me, you will stand before governors and kings as witness to them. Or verse 13, he says, all men will hate you because of me. So now this persecution becomes very, very personal. It's something that is happening to me personally. I am personally going to be persecuted. Why? Because of my personal relationship with Jesus Christ. And according to the Bible, this is something that Jesus told us to be aware of. John chapter 15, verses 18 to 21. If the world hates you, keep in mind that it hated me first. If you belong to the world, it would love you as its own. As it is, you do not belong to the world, but I have chosen you out of the world. That is why the world hates you. Now listen to what he's saying. The world hates you because you don't belong to the world, but rather you belong to me. Remember the words I spoke to you. No servant is greater than his master. If they persecuted me, they'll persecute you also. If they obeyed my teaching, they will obey yours also. They will treat you this way because of my name, for they do not know the one who sent me. Jesus says, now listen, persecution is coming. And this persecution is going to be personal. It's going to be because you love me. And that's exactly what happened to Lieutenant Commander Wesley J. Mauder. You need to know about Lieutenant Commander Wesley J. Mauder. Lieutenant Commander Wesley J. Mauder has been in the service for 15 years. He served in the Marine Corps. He served for 2 years with SEAL Team 6. He is a decorated Navy chaplain. Last December, this decorated Navy chaplain had a new assistant for 5 weeks. The new assistant for 5 weeks came in and said, you know, let's talk a little bit about marriage. Let's talk about what you think about homosexuality. It was a private conversation between Lieutenant Wesley J. Mauder and an assistant. This year, a knock comes to his door, and this assistant for 5 weeks was offended because Lieutenant Wesley J. Mauder said, you know, I believe in biblical Christianity. I believe homosexuality is wrong. I believe marriage is between a man and a woman. As a result of that, Lieutenant Wesley J. Mauder, 15 years in the military, served alongside the Marines, the Navy, and for 2 years with SEAL Team 6. He is being stripped of his duties at the nuclear facility in South Carolina. He may be forced out of the Navy, and he has been removed from the promotion list. Why? One reason. Quote, I am a follower of Jesus Christ. The Bible says, Jesus says, now look, this persecution that's coming, I want you to understand. It is personal. It is because of me, because of your relationship with me. Verse number 4. Jordan, could we go to presence? Could you go to the PowerPoint where it says presence? If you would take your Bible and go with me to Luke chapter 21, verse 12. In Luke chapter 21, verse 12, here's what the Bible says. But before all of this, they will lay hands on you and persecute you. They will deliver you to synagogues and prisons so that you will be brought before kings and governors and all on account of my name. Now, I want you to think about this for a moment. The Bible says, but before all of this. So if you were to read Luke chapter 21 in context, here's what you would find. He says, I want you to understand that many are going to come and they're going to deceive you. I want you to understand that there's going to be wars and rumors of wars. There's going to be a lot of problems. But then Luke says, but before all of this, there's going to be persecution. And so what many Bible expositors believe is that the persecution is going to intensify even before the deception, even before the wars and rumors of war, even before all of the natural disasters. All of that's going to happen. So he says it's going to be a present persecution. Do we have any present persecution? Let me remind you of Aaron and Melissa Klein. Aaron and Melissa Klein of Sweet Cakes by Melissa said one thing. We will not make a wedding cake for a homosexual wedding. That's all they said. And as a result of them saying no, they were fined $135,000 because the couple who they would not make their wedding cake for, the lesbian couple, said that they have been damaged emotionally. So this Christian couple, young couple, 4 children, now have $135,000 judgment against them today. This is present persecution. But not only do they have $135,000 judgment against them, Thursday, in the United States of America, in Oregon, they were forbidden. The government now forbids them even to speak about it. Present persecution. Not only are they fined $135,000 for not baking the cake, but they are told, you're not even allowed to talk about it. That is present persecution. The Bible tells us in verse 9. You must be on your guard. You will be handed over to the local council and flogged in the synagogues. On account of me, you will stand before governors and kings as witnesses to them. The Bible says this will be a positive persecution. How is it positive? Well, the Bible says you will be a witness to them. That word witness is the Greek noun martorion. And martorion is translated into English as martyr. The Bible says you will be a martyr for the cause of Christ. It will be positive for you when you stand before kings and authority and you're willing to give your life for Jesus Christ as a witness, as a martyr. It is positive. Luke chapter 21, verse 13 says this. This will result in your being witnesses to them. Do you remember about a decade ago, Joseph saw and spoke in our pulpit? Do you remember Joseph? Joseph was kicked out of Romania by Nicolae Ceaușescu. Joseph was imprisoned by Nicolae Ceaușescu. And Nicolae Ceaușescu sent his thugs to Joseph, and they put a gun to his head, and they said, recant your Christianity. Do you remember what Joseph said? Joseph said, listen, go ahead and shoot me, because as soon as you shoot me, the blood of Joseph Son spatters all of my messages. And everybody's going to say, hey, if Joseph's willing to die for the cause of Christ, it must be something I should really go back and read again. The Bible says that when you are a witness for Jesus, a martyr for Jesus, it becomes a positive testimony because you're willing to die for Christ. So some of our persecution is positive if you become a martyr for the cause of Christ. But now there's a promise. Look at verse 11. There's a great promise. Whenever you are arrested and brought to trial, don't worry beforehand about what to say. Just say whatever is given to you at the time, for it is not you speaking, but the Holy Spirit. He says, now listen, I want to tell you, I'm with you in this persecution. You remember the Gospel of Mark is written to Christians who are in Rome, and Nero is about to begin his persecution. He's about to have Christians put in the arena and fed the lions. He's about to have Christians on the lampstands at night lighting his garden. He's about to have Christians put in sarcophaguses with nails so that as they close, they're killed. He says, listen, whenever you're called before these authorities, I'm going to tell you, I will give you the words to say. As a matter of fact, Dr. Luke puts it this way. I will give you words and I will give you wisdom that none of your adversaries will be able to resist. So part of the promise of God is as this persecution comes your way, God makes a promise. And his promise is, I will be there with you. I have been persecuted. I'll be there with you. And I promise to give you the words and I promise to give you the wisdom that you need in that time. That is exactly the promise that God fulfilled to the prophet Jeremiah. God said in Jeremiah 1:9, then the Lord reached out his hand and touched my mouth and said to me, now I have put my words in your mouth. God promises to give us words and wisdom as we're called before the authorities. Some of the persecution is going to be parental. If you look at verse 12, here's what he says. Brother will betray brother to death. And a father, his child. Children will rebel against their parents and have them put to death. So parents are going to turn against children, and children are going to turn against parents. So while some of the persecution is parental, some of it is also going to be patriotic, because Dr. Luke adds this. He says, you will be betrayed even by parents and brothers, but you will also be betrayed by relatives and friends, and they will put some of you to death. Listen, in the days of Rome, all you had to do was say that Caesar is Lord and you would go unpunished. But in the days of Christian persecution, parents would tell on their children. Children would tell on their parents. Neighbors would tell, hey, look, he's not willing to say Caesar is Lord. Is it possible that it could be that persecution might even become patriotic in America? Well, it is possible. I want you to know that on June 29th, Freedom to Marry campaign director Mark Solomon argued that refusing to provide services for same-sex weddings is, quote, a non-American approach. So now if you don't perform same-sex weddings, you are a non-American. And if, quote, if you're open to business, you're open to business for everybody. Or you might know that there have been increasing calls from Time Magazine and others that once the Supreme Court passed marriage is between a man and a man, or a lady and a lady, as well as a man and a woman, if the church says, no, we will not do it, now Time Magazine and others are calling that you and I will lose our tax-exempt status. And it will be un-American for a church to say, no, we won't do that, which we said this week to a couple that came to our church. Who knows where that's going to go. What about the Oklahoma Supreme Court? July 1st, an Oklahoma Supreme Court ruled Tuesday that the Ten Commandments on the Oklahoma Capitol grounds must be removed because it violates the state's constitutional. So there you go. You can't even have the Ten Commandments on the state Capitol grounds. Persecution will be patriotic. Finally, we come to verse 13. In verse 13, Jesus says, all men will hate you because of me, but he who stands firm to the end will be saved. In other words, I believe that what you're going to begin seeing is you're going to see congregations start getting smaller and smaller and smaller. And the reason they'll be getting smaller and smaller and smaller is because persecution is coming our way. And what the Bible says, what Jesus says is this, a sure proof that you are a believer in Jesus Christ is that you hang in there and you don't quit on church and Jesus. Here's what the Bible says in 1 John 2:19. They went out from us, but they did not really belong to us. For if they had belonged to us, they would have remained with us. But their going showed that none of them belonged to us. So the proof that you're a believer in Jesus Christ, the proof that you're a Christian, the proof that the gospel of Jesus Christ is paramount in your life is that you are persevering in your faith. The Bible says in 1 John 2:19, you left. The proof is that you are not one of us because you chose not to stay with us during the times of persecution. Now I skip the verse. I skip to verse 10. Verse 10 says this. And the gospel must first be preached to all nations. So the Bible says now the gospel has to be preached to all nations. And that's the purpose of us doing shoeboxes. We share the shoeboxes so that boys and girls can know Jesus Christ. Our children learned, and you would have been proud on Wednesday night here, child after child after child. Quote Matthew chapter 28, verse 19. Therefore go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. One of the reasons that we do shoeboxes is because shoeboxes can go so many places that missionaries can. For example, President Reagan and his wife, they packed a shoebox, and their shoebox went to a place called Dubai, D-B-Y-E, Lebanon. And in Dubai, Lebanon, the shoebox team, the Samaritan's First shoebox team, went to a dwelling that had two rooms and eight people living in there. In the two rooms with eight people crowded in there, the shoebox team went, and only a sovereign God could do this, because as they took their shoebox to this home, they didn't know that a 14-year-old girl had just given birth to a young baby girl. This young baby girl was 9 days old. This young baby girl was living in a home, two rooms, eight people. The mother, Dalil, 14 years old, obviously had nothing. And here came the shoebox team. And what did President and Mrs. Reagan pack in their shoebox? But they had things for a new baby girl. Who but the Holy Spirit could ordain that? And not only was there clothing for a young baby girl, not only were there toys, there was also a stuffed gray elephant that the Reagans sent along. And as the shoebox team was sharing why they were there, they also shared the story of God's love for humanity and how much God loved them. And that's why they were there. And they told the birth of Jesus at Christmas time. And just as they were telling about the birth of Jesus and why they were there, Khalil's older brother came in, a crack addict. And as that crack addict came in, he was overwhelmed with the fact that the American president would send a shoebox for his 14-year-old sister, that it would contain gifts for his niece. And this crack addict, before the team left, bowed his head and prayed and received Jesus Christ as a Savior. That's why we do shoeboxes. Jesus said in Mark 13:10, the gospel must be first preached to all the nations. But now he's talking about the second coming of Jesus. So before Jesus returns, God, this gracious God that we have, is going to make sure that everybody has heard the gospel. You know how he's going to do that? Of course you do. One of the ways he's going to do that is in Revelation chapter 7, verse 14. There's going to be 144,000 Jewish evangelists sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ. In Revelation 11:3, there are going to be two supernatural witnesses that are going to live for 3.5 years. Quite possibly, there'll be Enoch and Elijah sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ. And then in Revelation 14:6-7, an angel is going to fly over the world and share the gospel of God. What a great God we have. He's going to give everybody an opportunity to hear the gospel of Jesus Christ through those the 144,000 witnesses, the two witnesses, the angel doing the flyover, and then you and me sharing shoeboxes with boys and girls around the world. You know, the Bible says in 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 9, that God is so gracious, so loving, he's not willing that any should repent. He's not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. Let me ask you, are you sure that today if you die, you go to heaven? Here's what the Bible says. God loves you so much, loves you so much, he sent his son Jesus to die on the cross for your sins. And here's what you need to do. You need to first of all realize that you're a sinner. The Bible says all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. We're all sinners. The Bible says the wages of sin is death. We're all going to die. The Bible says the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Just as the Samaritan's first shoebox came from a shoebox and said to Delilah, here is a gift. All she had to do was reach out and take it. You have to take the gift of salvation. You have to reach out and say, yes, I'm a sinner. And the Bible says in John 1:12, as many as received him, as many as received the gift, to them he gives the authority to become a child of God. And the Bible says, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I'll come to him. Now, let me ask you, are you a Christian? Are you sure that today you're ready to meet God? Because in a few moments we're going to stand and sing a hymn of invitation. And today, you can take my hand and say, Pastor, I want to become a Christian. But before we leave here today, I want to connect with this sermon, and I want to connect five different ways. And here's my first connection point. First of all, is this. Persecution isn't separation. The Bible tells us in Romans chapter 8, verse 35, that nothing can separate you from the love of God. So as you stand true to Jesus, and as persecution might come your way, like it did to Aaron and Melissa Klein, stay true to Jesus, because persecution certainly isn't separation. And the persecution will come, and the persecution will come because of Jesus. 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 16. However, if you suffer as a Christian, do not be ashamed, but praise God that you bear the name. Stay true to Jesus. Tertullian, a first century church father born in AD 60 in Carthage, North Africa, said, we multiply whenever we are mowed down by you. Listen, he said, when persecution comes, the true believer stands strong and will multiply because we'll stand true to Jesus. Persecution will come. And it comes because of Jesus. And I'd like to encourage you to join our citizenship ministry team. Our goal is to elect godly men and godly women to the city councils, to the school boards, to state and local offices. I'd like to encourage you to join our citizenship ministry team. The Bible says in Proverbs chapter 14, verse 34, that righteousness exalts a nation. If you want to have a righteous nation, then you have to have righteous people. And how do you have a righteous people? Well, the Bible says in 2 Corinthians 5:17 that if any man be in Christ, he's a new creation. All things are passed away. All things have become new. If you want to have a righteous nation, you have to have righteous people. Righteous people are people that have Jesus in their heart. So you and I have got done to go out and share the gospel of Jesus Christ. I want to remind you what George Washington says about a righteous nation. It is impossible to rightly govern the world without God and the Bible. That's what President Washington said. I want to remind you what Daniel Webster said. Whatever makes men good Christians makes them good citizens. And I want to remind you what Thomas Jefferson said. Thomas Jefferson said, the democracy will cease to exist when you take away from those who are willing to work and give to those who would not. I want to encourage you to take out that FOI card in your bulletin and join our citizenship ministry team. But you know, I shared with you, if we're going to be a righteous nation, you have to have people coming to know Christ. You have to have a change of heart and a change of nature. And that comes as you and I purposely are an evangelistic church. And I'd like to encourage you to help us in evangelism. First of all, shoeboxes. We are doing 611 shoeboxes this year. It is estimated that every shoebox shares the gospel 7 times. So when 611 shoeboxes go out this door, that's 4,277 people that are going to hear about Jesus. Next Saturday is Vacation Bible School. You can help us in Bible school. You can pray. You can come work. You can invite your neighbors. Help us with Bible school. November 2015, My Hope with Billy Graham. We'll be showing it here in the church, or you can open your home. You can say, Pastor, I'm going to do a neighborhood showing of My Hope with Billy Graham. You can begin right now praying and inviting your neighbors. Invite them to your home. Plug in the DVD with Billy Graham and have a 30-minute visit with you, your neighbors, and Billy Graham. My Hope with Billy Graham. Easter, March 27th, 2016. Easter Sunday morning. We're going to have an evangelistic service at 9:30 in the morning. You should be right now praying about who you'll invite. Invite your neighbors. They'll come Easter Sunday morning. And then you could be a neighborhood prayer walker. Why in the world could you not walk up and down the streets of your neighborhood and pray silently, Dear God, bring my neighbors to repentance. Dear God, when I invite them to My Hope with Billy Graham, I pray that they'll come. Dear God, I pray that this coming Easter, when I invite my neighbors, that they will come. You could be a neighborhood prayer walker, and you could be a Saturday prayer for Sunday Power. You don't even have to leave your home. You don't have to leave your easy chair. All you have to do is say, Pastor, I'm going to pray on Saturday for Sunday Power. That's all you have to do. And we will give you a time to pray. We'll tell you what to pray. You don't have to walk out of your home. You just take 10 to 15 minutes and say, Dear God Almighty, I want to pray for our church services tomorrow. Can you do that? Take that FOI card and fill it out. And let me tell you something. You think, well, you know, I don't think it's time for me to do that. Well, when you think of Aaron and Melissa Kline, when you think of us losing our tax exempt status, when you hear that it's un-American for a church to say that marriage is between a man or a woman, or when a young Christian couple loses their business and can't even talk about it in the United States of America, maybe it's time to become a Saturday prayer for Sunday Power. Now let me ask you this, my final question. Are you rapture ready? The next thing to happen in God's prophetic calendar is the rapture of the church. You'll have the rapture of the church. You'll have the tribulation. You'll have the second coming of Jesus. You'll have the millennial kingdom. He says these are the beginning of birth pain. As you see these things increasing, the deception, the wars, the natural disturbances, and as you see the persecutions increasing, he says, these are the beginning signs that my kingdom is coming. So I'm asking you, are you rapture ready? Are you ready today because you've admitted that you're a sinner in need of a Savior? You've asked Jesus into your heart and you're ready for the rapture. There are 4 choices you need to make this morning. Choice number 1 is this. Where are you going to spend eternity? Where will your eternal days be? The Bible says in Revelation chapter 20, verse 15, if your name is not in the Lamb's Book of Life, you'll not spend eternity in heaven with God. How does my name get in the Lamb's Book of Life? Very simply. I admit I'm a sinner. I ask Jesus to come into my life as my Lord and Savior. I repent of my sins, and Jesus is my Savior. Is he your Savior? If he's not your Savior, your name's not in the Lamb's Book of Life. I would ask you this question. If not today, when? If today isn't the day for you to become a Christian, if today isn't the day for you to settle your eternal destination, if it's not today, when would it be? And then I would ask you this question. How? Or do you want to live your earthly days? Do you want to walk out of here? Blessed by God you can. Here's what the Bible says in Psalms 119:1. Blessed are they whose ways are blameless, who walk according to the law of the Lord. Do you want to walk out here protected in this age of persecution? You can. Proverbs 28:6. He who trusts in himself is a fool, but he who walks in wisdom is safe. Do you want to walk out of here right, knowing that you're on the right side of God? Do you want that? Well, you can. Proverbs 2:9. Then you will understand what is right and just and fair. So my last and final question to you is this. What are you going to do with today's truth? Because the Holy Spirit has promised that He speaks to each of us. And during this message, He's spoken to you, and I'm asking you, what will you do with the truth that you have received today? Let's pray together. Father, thank you for Jesus, and thank you for the gift of eternal life. Now, Father, it is my prayer that on this day, as we prepare to stand and to sing a hymn of invitation, my prayer, Father, is simply this. If there is somebody who's not a Christian, that today they will step out of their seat, walk down this aisle, and say, today is the day I'm giving my life to Jesus. But, Father, beyond that, this is a day when we Christians have got to understand that you've told us that persecution will come. And you have told us to be prepared. You yourselves, be prepared. So, Father, today, let us not walk out of this building blind. Let us not walk out of this building thinking that everything is right in the United States of America, because it isn't. But Lord, what I do know is this, that righteousness exalts a nation, and righteousness comes when men and women and boys and girls say, I'm a sinner, I need a Savior, and they have a new life in Jesus Christ. God Almighty, I pray that men and women are filling out those FOI cards and are saying, I'll be a Saturday prayer for Sunday Power. I will be a neighborhood prayer walker. You can count on me to be a part of my hope with Billy Graham in November. Father, thank you for Jesus. Thank you for this day. And thank you for the gift of eternal life. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Let's stand. All to Jesus I surrender. All to Him I freely give. Let's stand, let's sing it together. I'll meet you at the altar if you'd like to make a decision.